Now, a lot of you are excited to finally meet Pamela Erlin in person. She's one of the most genuine, warm, beautiful people I've ever met. Pamela's been a clear channel since the age of 5. I was led to Pamela's work somehow by divine guidance on the internet. And I listen to almost all of Pamela's videos. When I get hooked on somebody, I check everything out. And I contacted her for an interview. And so I interviewed her, and then she had me on her show. And that was a lot of fun. She's got a lot of followers, and there's a really good reason why. I found her to be the real deal. And somehow, by divine guidance, I became an intermediary to introduce her to one of our speakers last year, Candace Crawl Goldman, because I found out through Pamela's videos that she was channeling Dolores Cannon. I'm like, oh, I know somebody that you need to meet. And Candace was very skeptical. She's like, I don't know, Dolores said she'd never come through the channel ever. And I said, well, I'm sorry, but she is. And it's real deal. I love you. You need to trust me. And here we are. And so Dolores is obviously here. And Pamela has much to share about the A-Team and many other things. And I don't know how we're going to fit this all in 1 hour. But let's just stretch time. Let's do
that's
that.
Right. That's right.
So all of Pamela's bookings have been taken up, but she does, you can sign up on AuraReader.com. And so with that, I give you Pamela Erlin.
First of all, I love you. I want you to feel that for a moment. I love you. I wish, and my intention is for you in this channeling to see within my reflection exactly the loving, compassionate, united, powerful, divine beings that you are today. That is my intention. We're going to start with a frequency healing. You can just sit back and allow these frequencies to come through you in any way that they will, within your own intention. Connect to the I Am within you. Please connect to your heart centers. This is me showing you exactly how I see you and how I feel you, rather.
Tatsavitravarayiriyam Bhagavad-Vasyam
When I was traveling on the way here, I was trying to determine what I wanted to channel, who I wanted to channel. Christ of consciousness automatically came to my heart when a combination of Krishna and Yeshua began to step through while I was on the plane to discuss compassion. And I pulled out my laptop and I channeled exactly what I'm going to say to you now. I'm going to read it directly as it was channeled. Remind me some tissues. I feel a cry coming on.
For those of you who watch my channeling, you understand this cry is going to happen at some point.
Not going to make any apologies. Humanity is entering an exciting precipice of self-awareness, compassion, and inevitably self-love in its most divine form. Source is expressing in our heart centers like never before. But since we have been trained in our left brain centers, logical states rather, to shut down emotions, and that emotions are not credible or valid according to what we've been taught in our educational systems, societies, and by our parents, humans are designed based on DNA that is, for the first time in Earth's history, awakening in its divine fullness. We are expanding rapidly into learning to cease thinking within the left brain states and opening to the active brains in our heart and chakras, which opens us up naturally into the fullness of source-centered feeling in our right brain states. This is source. There is a majority and a major component missing in the human conscious collective's awareness regarding spiritual awakening. The love-centered revival of the art of holding space is known as compassion. This is what it will take to release the current human conscious collective states of fear and to ascend in our awareness within unity. Unity within compassion is where we are going next in our ascension and awakening. Let's discover together the definition of compassion. Com is a Latin derivative meaning with. Passion holds its own feeling-based definition. So can you please drop into your heart centers for a moment and define, if ever briefly, not with your logic, not with your left brain, but with your hearts, What does it mean to you, and how does it feel? That passion part of the word, compassion. What do you think about? What would your lives look like if you had passion? If you were with passion, you would be united with yourselves and with others. Once humanity fully allows for enough compassionate presence for both themselves and others, the human conscious collective can further expand towards its new earth journey of ascension, which is why I've channeled the compassionate presence response process for you today. For your heart-centered consideration, compassion belongs everywhere and anywhere. You are each worthy of it. Every human, every animal, every living being on planet Earth deserves and requires compassion, no matter the circumstance. Let that one sink in, no matter the circumstance. And there will be many questions in relation to the who, the what, the why, what someone did to you or to others, and your perceptions. And this fear-based harm caused by beings who have raped, killed, abused themselves and others, this comes from a space of lack, a lack of compassion, and a lack of love. But ask yourselves, can lack heal lack? No. Only love and compassion within your empathy can heal the fear-based traumas that cause such deep wounds in these souls. So who are we to judge them? Could it not have been either of us in their shoes? With the correct alignment and circumstances and pre-birth intention-based choices, could it not have been any of us in their shoes? The person who hurt you, I urge you today to step with a unity of forgiveness and step through your hearts and look deep. The compassionate presence response is what Yeshua is calling CPR. Right? This is what we need because we are in a human current conscious state of emergency. I'm going to say that again. We are in a state of an emotional and frequency emergency. We are also at a very exciting precipice in humanity because if you think about it, the bridge is right here. This is you, everyone in this room today. You are bridging the third dimension and fifth and up. You are that bridge. And what Michelle was discussing earlier, you know, about me being a fourth dimensional bridge and me choosing to not ascend. Oh, yeah, let's talk about that. I'm not in a hurry to leave this planet. Yeah, I can see what's going on. I'm from those spaceships. Of course I can get up on it if I want. I don't want to. I urge you to ask yourselves, would you care to join me in being that bridge? Would you care to step into your human purpose? Many people come to me and say, I want to see like you. I want to channel like you. You know what I like to do? I like to turn it off and allow Yeshua to put me in his arms and hug me until I feel like him. I want to feel you. And I want you to feel yourselves, that heart center awareness. That's what's going to turn on any extraneous human sense. Anything that you long for with what each of you are wanting to do within wanting to see, wanting to hear, wanting to feel, wanting psychometry, wanting to speak to the deceased, wanting to channel ascended beings and angels, it starts here, right here. When you hold enough compassion and awareness for yourselves, when you unite with yourselves, then you will reunite with others. When that happens, your world will be turned upside down. So many people come up to me and they say, Pamela, oh my goodness, I hugged you and my third eye opened. I'm like, no, you didn't. I'm a reflection of you. I hugged you, which means you hugged you. You felt love for yourself for that brief moment within the reflection of love that I was showing you to give you permission, that it takes me as an embodied human to give you permission to love yourself, to turn on your third eye. So for those of you that were hugging me today and remarking on what a wonderful hugger I am, that was me channeling you, allowing you to step through one brief moment of self-love and then
you would feel me touch you in this area or move in this area to open up the chakra systems for you. Then and only then could that happen. And that was just me facilitating what you want by allowing you to love yourselves. That is the key. Compassionate presence via a response, not a reaction. That's why we didn't call it compassionate presence reaction. When Yeshua channeled this on the plane, we were sitting there trying to come up with a word. And I leaned over to Jim and I said, compassionate presence process? No, CPP, no. Compassionate presence, it's gotta be CPR. And I said, I just don't get it. What's that last word? Resilience? You know, what is it? What is it? What is it? Is it reaction? No, reacting is from a fear-based, trauma-based circumstance. That's what we don't want you to do. We want you to respond to others. I'm going to read the steps of the process now to hold compassionate presence for another being. And I would like for you to consider that you can turn this around on yourselves also. It's for both. It's very equally important that you do this for yourselves, actually. Step number one, show compassion. The first response necessary when holding space for another is to consider their emotional state a true presence and mannerism of energetic emergency. Please refrain from your judgment, leave all criticism in the left brain state by actively choosing to drop into your heart centers. Here is how. Number two, eye contact. What I was showing you today was the compassionate presence response. This is why I tried to hug every single person that walked in my direction. This was me showing you this. Notice the first thing I did? Mm-hmm. You could feel me. Most people can. But you can see me because I'm looking at you and I'm giving you permission to love yourselves. This is what I'd like you to do for your friends, family, and loved ones. So the second step again, Yeshua says eye contact. Make sure you get as close to the person as would be comfortable for both of you. Be aware of their body language when discerning exactly how close to get to them. Some of you prefer hand-holding. Some don't wish to be touched at all. Honor that. You're here not to break down another person's wall, not to chisel it down and come in with your compassion and say, oh! No. You're here, and when you find someone that doesn't want to be hugged, some of you didn't, so what I did was I touched you on the arm. Within a certain space, just kind of close your arms and just look at you. That may be needed because you're not here to break down that wall. You're here to be present on that wall, present on the other side, just letting the person know, I am here for you. I am completely here with you right now. I'm not distracted with my cell phone. I'm not thinking about what I'm going to say next after you say something to me. I'm not thinking about how I'm going to respond with you because I'm not thinking at all. I am feeling you. This is how Yeshua describes it to me. He's not thinking. He's feeling within the other person. There is a role of the journeyer and there is a role of the receiver. Be the journeyer and then switch, feel what that person needs. And then within the states of giving and receiving, the love and compassion that forms between the two of you will form unity. And then you will find yourself receiving. You will find your walls coming down. Candace and I do this all the time. We can just walk in each other's presence and burst into tears for no apparent reason because we are giving and receiving. Within a state of trust, that person is not thinking that I'm judging them. That person's not thinking, oh, it's Pamela Erlin, I wonder what she's thinking of me. That person's thinking, oh my gosh, I'm loved. That's what I would like for you to show your loved ones, that they are loved, that they can be accepted. Okay, so step three, respond with words of reassurance and validation. There is nothing worse. There is no greater feeling than invalidation. When you really are having a difficult time and someone comes up to you and you really feel it and you just feel it in their eyes that they really need you to hold that space. And what do you say to them because you're nervous, because you're not sure that you can hold space? You're like, it's gonna be okay. Mm-hmm. It's okay. Don't you hate those words? Mm-hmm. It's a strong word, right? I despise the words, it's okay, because it is not. You don't know if it's gonna be okay. Why should you, person? I don't. Yeshua steps through me and he says, I see you. I feel you. I feel that you're not okay. I am completely here with you right now. It is completely safe for you to feel and express what you are feeling and expressing. I don't know that it's going to be okay. I just know that I love you and you are safe. You know how powerful that is? I love you and you are safe. Love without, love whatever arises without condition. Step four, allow for whatever arises and come forth from the person in your space with love, then listen. Remember, you're not there to fix. You're not there to say, this is what you do. Love is not an action state, love is a being state. So keep in mind, you are there to love whatever is coming up. And ask yourself a very vital question. This is a question in step four that Yeshua channeled in this process. And the question is, if I were personally experiencing this person's pain, how would I want someone to support me? What would I want them to say or do with anything? Action comes last. And finally, wait a minute, we have two more. Don't leave. I think that's a big one. Hold space. Don't get up. Don't look at your phone. Don't be distracted. Give that person the value and the love that they absolutely want. Holding a true compassionate presence for others means you also respond in consistency and stability by staying the course. Your actions will mean less. Your words will mean more. And finally, step six here. Provide approval or permission. This person, have you ever felt that from people when they're really looking for compassionate presence and they kind of just are looking with their eyes and you're feeling it that they just don't know? And the question is, what about you next? How many times have you asked yourself that in your life when you're in complete turmoil and in a giant spiritual awakening and transition? That is the number one question that people ask for me. What do I do next? And Yeshua's answer is always, be still. Be still. If you don't know what to do next, what it is akin to is having, when you say, I don't know, that means you really don't. You're not choosing anything. So why should you have to? You have one foot on a banana peel and the other foot currently in your trauma. So why should you move around on that banana peel? It's a little dangerous, right? So when you don't know, the answer is don't do. Feel. Okay, so the compassionate presence response was, it came really quickly. I had no idea what we were going to do with that, but there you have it. Before I even read about it, before it's even published, I gave it to you. You are worthy. You are loved. This is the biggest message from Yeshua today, is that he told me to express to you, hold a compassionate space for yourselves and others as you step into unity. Unity within compassion, again, is where we're going in the next state of human conscious ascension. In our collectives, that's where we're going. What I'd like to do next is for you. I am here for you. That process was for you, that healing is for you, and now the rest of our time is to be completely about you, because that's how much Yeshua loves you. That's how much I love you. I would like for one of you, many of you actually, to raise your hands and think of a question. If you could ask these beings that are coming through me today, Krishna, Yeshua, Buddha, Isa, Sai Baba's here today, surprise. If you could ask anyone, Dolores Cannon's been here today. For those of you who are familiar with my work, we have what I call the A-Team, which I'll briefly talk about that. That is Dolores Cannon, Nikola Tesla, Albert Einstein, Newton, and Dr. Emoto. And that's why I've been drinking my love-infused water today. For those of you who are wondering why I'm here around these crystals. I would like for you to raise your hands and consider if you could ask any of these beings anything today. The rest of this time is yours. And I'm going to choose based upon frequency. You didn't even raise your hand.
I would just like to hear Yeshua's response to everyone on his channel teaching of A Course in Miracles.
You get it?
There are many beautiful writings. Word came before light. My word are your words. This word is just as pure. Many will receive love and compassion and truth within your own discernments. But you are consciously and subconsciously choosing and discerning within this scripture and many others exactly what you require in each moment for your individual states of healing. This is truth, but truth is relative. What shall you choose?
Who's next?
Lift hands again.
I have fear of speaking for people. I guess anything that comes through.
You're in a current state of transition. Your choice of who you deem as family is pertinent right now. Receiving trust, understanding that you cannot be harmed, is of utmost significance in your heart right now. Trust, you will know your answer, not when you think, but when you feel. I am there with you. Sometimes no answer is the answer. Can you stand in this and trust? I love you. Next.
That's you. She's like.
Quick question on tears. You brought up Dr. Emoto, and I cry a lot. I cry constantly. So if I were to look at these tears under a microscope, it's been a whole thing, like trying to keep them back. But maybe I should just let them flow. How does that tune in with the emotion? Thank you.
From Dr. Emoto?
No, from you.
From me? Okay. I'm like, okay.
What's your take on tears?
The cells act in unusual ways. I'm sorry, it's going to be Emoto first. Here we go. So the cell membranes in the body are all united based upon peptides that are released from brain matter. So when that happens, when your emotions come, your cell membranes expand, peptides are released, your body responds, the glands in and around this area start to move. It is a part of a release system. You need to release this, but it requires acceptance first, accepting your tears, accepting that they're happening, minus the shame. Many people who wouldn't, when they go into tears, will automatically go into guilt and shame. It's very important that you step through in a state of love and allowance for the fact that you are crying, that there is no shame in that you are crying, that you can authentically be exactly who you are, okay? So tears are a release. Basically, energetically and emotionally, you are releasing emotional toxins. You're releasing many toxins that are stuck in the cellular walls that are, cellular membranes rather, that are, I love it when dead people correct you, cellular membranes, not walls. And he's like, we're not animals, you're talking to a human. So cellular membrane, you are releasing toxins.
This one's for Tesla. I'd like to ask if his scalar energy is enough to help me improve my psychic talents, or should it be complemented with other things such as crystals?
What was the first thing you said? What kind of energy?
Scalar energy.
He says your frequency and your resonance does align with that.
Okay.
But of course, there will be many times when your alignment changes. I'm glad you asked that, because that gives me a chance to address collectively the energetic tools that you are using. Your frequencies are changing every time you have an emotion, which is pretty much, if you're an empath like me, it's every time you breathe. So please,
you're going to need a lot of different tools, especially you. He said especially you, but that does align strongly with you right now.
Okay, thank you.
All right, next. Candace, are you raising your hand?
Yes.
Go for it.
Well, I guess we're coming to you then.
I am. Trying to get your attention.
I have a question about our companion animals. For Yeshua, of course.
Right?
Because of the Yeshua voice is already coming out, right?
We know this, right?
My question is, so for me personally, even though I'm in a service to humanity realm, I have an equal passion for animals, especially companion animals. I have a big collection of them. My question is how to be loving and assisting them, not only in what their goals are for their service to humanity, but for themselves as individual beings when they are themselves in need. My love for animals is so strong. I can help humans all day long in a way, sometimes from a place of greater strength than I can for the animals. And I'm needing some help understanding. I have so many animals, and many of them have had things happen lately, and I'm trying my best to help and assist them while not standing in their way of their goals. And I need to understand a little more, not only for myself, but to help the people who come to me about our companion animals. What is too much? What is real? What are they about? How can we live in a higher place together?
He says that it's all real. It's all valid. It's all love. But keep in mind, the souls of animals are shifting. It used to be, and I noticed what he's talking about, because 20 years ago, when I first started this work, animals were coming in sort of piggybacking onto the souls of us within a specific type of contract. But I don't know if you've noticed, have you noticed that animals now are formulating their own individual frequencies as guides to us? This is what's going on with your companion animals. The energies are frequency, the frequencies are shifting. And you'll notice that when you bring in a wild animal, a stray being, things of that nature, for what we call them anyway. They're not stray. You know exactly that they're aligned to you. You know exactly that they have a pre-birth intention to stand in your presence. They are transmuting. They do that for you. And then when they're in pain, your soul chooses to do that for them. This is the ultimate unity. Animals are innocent beings that are loving, the most pure, innocent beings, more so than humans, because humans have been infiltrated, unfortunately, by society and educational systems and governmental systems and whatnot. Animals come in pure, and you have so much love for them because they are trying to teach you to do the same for yourselves. You can use them and they can use you. It is a symbiotic spiritual relationship that is meant to continue infinitely as long as Earth exists. You understand? It's for you, it's for them, it's for everyone. So keep doing it.
You two have such a strong connection that I couldn't put the microphone between you.
I love her so much. It'll make me cry. You know what you...
I've been told a few times that I could be a medical intuitive, so I'm not sure who to ask, but I'm just, I haven't been able to figure out or see or even feel how that, what I can do to pursue that. Is that something that seems...
You know how I know you're a medical intuitive? I'm drawn to you guys. First of all, I'm in a crowd and I see them because it's right here. When I talk, you are the safe person that I picked, and I don't even know you. You are my safe person. A medical intuitive has so much in the eyes. This is crown energy, such a knowingness that when you look at them, they are seeing you. They are seeing you without filters. I bet you're very non-judgmental.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you're operating fully without duality at this stage in your development. Good for you. Yes, of course you're a medical intuitive. You already know that and you don't need to ask me.
I just can't figure out what path to take to get there and do that. I'm not working
on this. Is the Yeshua channel message. Sometimes it feels a little bit like throwing yourself at a wall, and that wall is earth. That wall is your fear. Earth is your fear, how you are received by others, if you're accurate, if you're not, if it's going to help people, if it's not, what to do with it, how to make money from it. Toss it all and just stand in your feeling. Do what you did with me quickly, straighten the eyes, right? And when you are medically intuiting someone, you are offering them a service of your heart and of your crown chakra. Go, do, and then be all of it. Just go. Just go do. Of course we can talk about get a website, get this, get that, get a blah, 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 blah. It doesn't matter how. It doesn't matter how. It doesn't matter how much you charge for. It doesn't matter if you put it on a website or if you do it in person. You are infinitely gifted. And it needs to be expressed. And when you are expressing in your passion, with passion, this is mastery. And no matter what you do, how you do it, you will thrive. You will stand in abundance. Money will come. Clients will come. They will come. Oh, I feel like I'm quoting something from the movies. If you build it, they will come. Yeah, please build. Build it.
Thank you.
Next.
Less for me to walk.
My grandfather, who passed away 10 years ago, came to me in a dream, and he said, "Stop telling people who you are. You'll scare them." And it's hard. Know that you're different. I don't want to tell people, but not like to scare the crap out of them. He's nervous about, and he's obviously a part of me. Mm-hmm. He's showing me this part of myself that is terrified of stepping into this new world of stuff that my friends react to like I'm a nut. When I was flying here, I asked for my crystals to be hand-checked, and there was a seam. So I would like to know, from the heart, going forward, I feel the sense of fearlessness, and I feel the sense of fear, and they go together. I just need help with that, because it's important to me to help as many people as possible. But scaring them, I can sense their energy moving away.
Let their energy move away then. And then what? If it were true that they were scared, this is a part of my resistance process. If it were true, how would you feel?
Sad.
That's the core imprint. You see how that fear goes with the fearlessness, and it's a big loop for you to experience that fear, and your grandfather was coming through to catalyze you to stand in that fear, embrace it, and say, okay, let them be afraid. I am Becky.
Well, they're going to be terrified.
I am Becky. That's it.
How scary.
I am Becky, and Becky is love. That's
scary. I think they're afraid of the love.
Yes, yeah, of course. Do you know how many of you I hugged today that when I hugged you, you were shaking? It was so hard to receive love. Humans aren't used to this. Receiving love appears to be a foreign concept. Right? That many of you, when I come up to hug you, automatically,
You just go, it's Pamela. Pamela put on her clothes and brushed her teeth and did everything just like I did. And believe me, her management team and lovely assistant in the back won't do it for her. Pamela was awakened by dead people all night. That's another story. It's not as grand as you believe. You, the Harvard educated. She is. I'm going to lift this being up for a moment. This is one of the most brilliant beings I've ever met in my lifetime.
Oh my God.
And yet you are afraid to stand in and say, I am Becky. I am beautiful. I am smart. I am gifted.
You have helped me, and you've seen me change.
I'm watching it powerfully.
Yeah, it's like
I'm watching this power come from you, and it's a wellspring from your souls when you're able to see a reflection of someone in front of you saying, you are beautiful, you are powerful, you are loved, you are worthy. This is the biggest problem in the Human Conscious Collective right now. Mm-hmm. This is the biggest problem, is that we believe we are not worthy. You are worthy. Next.
You're just making my job easy.
Okay, so lately, I feel so drawn to help suicidal people. And I get so attached to them because I feel like I'm a mother to them. And I just want to know what Yeshua has to say to me to help me be strong for them.
He says, thank you. Do you know how much courage it takes? Do you know how much unwavering tolerance, patience? He says, thank you. This is your path. You chose this path. What if it were okay, for those of you who have this similar calling, because I have a feeling that at least six of you do have a similar calling with helping suicidal people. Yeah. Clients and people and family and friends. What if it were okay if that person had a soul contract as an exit point to leave this earth, and that there was nothing that you can do but give them the most immense amounts of love that you could possibly give to them? Do you think that your job would then be good enough? Would it be okay then that they never got that in their entire lives, and that for one iota of the breath of time that you spent with them, that you gave them that love, that beauty, that gift of feeling loved before they chose to exit, that they can remember that as they're sitting there in the spirit world? Do you know how beautiful that is?
I'm feeling that question was meant from a lot of people in this room right now, and I know one in particular, so thank you for that question. Thank you, Pamela. I've been drawn a lot to a lot of people that, when they start telling these stories, there's just like this overwhelming sense that I need to hold them. I don't know exactly what I'm doing, so I don't know what it is I'm doing, but I don't know a name for it. I don't know what I'm doing, whether or not I'm helping them heal or what. I don't know. I'm like still new to all this, and it's coming on full speed ahead. So I don't know what I'm thank you.
And we got Tesla. He's never going to leave now. For those of you who follow my work, I always talk about this with Tesla. When he enters the building, he does not exit the building. He doesn't care what you're doing, what time of day it is. Transmutation. I'm going to tell you what it is. You take something in. It is matter. It is permanently changed into a higher frequency. And you get to reflect and choose that frequency, yourself and that soul, that being, that spirit. You're aligning and you're offering them something by taking in energy. Now, many Reiki masters, people who are teaching energy healing, will disagree with this principle. This is original alchemy. Alchemy. Let that sink in. Transmutation is when you pull in a frequency into your own frequency, and then it aligns, shifts, lifts, and then you give it back. The beautiful gift, and you need to follow it.
You said it aligns, shifts, and then...
lifts. Aligns, shifts, and lifts. You got it.
Raise your hand.
The ocean mother is crying for our help. I guess this is a question for the A-team on how we can transmute and support the cleansing of the waterways, especially the red tide around this area. What we can do, whether it's crystals, sound, whatever.
He asked me to do this. It's from Yeshua. The reason being, you notice that if you put energy into a crystal, if you bless, if you charge a crystal, and then you put it in water, and then you charge that water, that even the taste, the molecular structure of the water is shifting. That's from Tesla. So, yeah, we went through that today at lunch when I handed that exact glass of water to my business team, and he went, oh, it tastes like a shoe. That's because he's not used to receiving love. We're getting there. With that being stated, okay, we're sitting here next to Siesta Key. You know that? It is the most beautiful, high-frequency aligned place currently in this side of the planet. And when those of you get together, especially with this amount of people, go to the drum circle tonight. Go with people and put those energies, put those frequencies into those quartz crystals, into the sands there. Mm-hmm. And it's going to flow back into the water. It's about charging that, blessing the water, blessing the crystals, blessing the shores. You know, you can't focus on what you can't change. You could, but it would be an immense waste of time. So to shift into saying, well, these corporate environments, these governmental structures that control us, if you shift into that, you shift into a fear of allowing it to be so even more. Come together, ignore that. Ignore the fears. You can't do anything about it. Not right now. You know how you can do something about it, though? Shift into love. Unite your frequencies together. Stand on those sands barefooted and chant that love into those sands and watch it wash with the tides of the ocean. Watch it move. Watch it shift. Watch those oceans cleanse. Your belief will do so.
Thank you. The drum circle is tomorrow night. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow at 5:30.
I just want to make a comment about, I think it was like maybe 5 years ago, and Dr. Emoto was up in St. Petersburg, mm-hmm. and there was a huge group of us through the Unity Church and the wings and all that, and we went to the beach, and it was supposed to pour down rain, and we had drums, and he had crystals, and we were all praying. It was after they had the oil spill. We were all holding hands and praying on the water, and it rained all around us, and it didn't rain there. I kind of get like, whew, head to toe, and up above, the clouds parted, and we have pictures of this, into a huge heart. Yeah. And that was the only sky that was shown. And really, the blessing of the waters was just amazing. And, he, you know, that's what he's all about. Yeah.
It's very powerful.
Next. Gray sweater. Gosh, you all look so surprised when I choose you.
I have the mic, huh? Okay, I guess I'm just, as a mom of two in this busy, crazy culture that we're in, and I guess in the United States, I suppose, I'm not sure if it's everywhere, but I feel often very busy and overworked and overwhelmed a lot, even around my children, and I tend to not always respond, more likely react, the way I feel like my heart space would if I wasn't overwhelmed, always busy, and to an extent you can arrange around that and change your life, but in some ways you can't. Sometimes it's out of your control. There are things, the needs that need to be met, and things you need to do to survive, and blah, blah, blah. So my question is that with all of that, and with life as crazy as it can get, what's an easy and quick way to come back to me? Like if the kids are freaking out and I'm losing my mind and I don't know how to come back to reality, or not reality, but I don't want to come back to reality, but coming back to my heart space so that I can be a better person to my friends, my children, myself, my home. I guess I'm asking, like, is there, I don't actually have a process, but is there a quick way? People say come back to your breath, but I don't really find much relief with that. I have a hard time finding my breath when I'm, or I caring about my breath at that point, because is there anything that I can do to help me come back to the I am within me or my heart space or the things that, you know, we talk about coming back to love that's quick and easy? Is there that, or is it just making a choice?
Breathe.
Yeah. That fear, that is fear. What you're doing right now is called anxiety. Mm-hmm. Anxiety is a cover frequency for something you are afraid of, possibly involving the core belief of not good enough. What if everything you do in that moment, it doesn't matter if you're breathing, if you're turning on something silly on TV, or if you go take your children's hands and run into the rain, like a crazy woman.
Yes.
This is what I do when I get this way, by the way.
Okay.
When I'm feeling like I'm going to react to my children, for those of you mothers in the room, I'm not perfect. We're not perfect. So when we're going to react to our children and you know that you are operating from a space of tension, which is another cover from anxiety, that's what you're doing. Stop and go. Stop just for a second. And then just take that energy, breathe a couple of times, choose what you are going to transmute that into. So you would say, okay, first of all, identify. Validate what you're feeling and identify what you're feeling. So you would say, what is it I'm feeling right now in my heart? Drop it to your heart, put your hand on your chest, close your eyes, breathe in slowly, deeply, and ask yourself a very important question. What am I feeling? How am I feeling? This is a heart check. And then you will try to identify. And then you will say, I am completely here with you right now. It is completely safe to feel exactly what I am feeling. That is validation. That is compassion. This is a part of the compassionate presence response. You tend to react because you have tension as opposed to respond. This will slow you down so that you can learn to respond to your inner child, which is who we're trying to connect to. So with that being said, then ask, what would I rather feel instead of that? This is an alchemy question. Once you validate it, don't do it without validating, because that is spiritual bypassing, my friends. So after you validate, then you want to go ahead and say, you know, what would I rather feel instead? And then breathe in that color, choose a color, what color is it? Breathe it into your heart center or into the portion of your chakra system that feels that tension. And then go play, go take your kids off, go run into the rain. All that kind of stuff. Yeah. All right. I have really enjoyed this today, guys. Thank you so, so much for having me. I am grateful. I'm grateful and I'm blessed.
Thank you, Pamela. We love you.